All right. Hey, listen, why don't we scrap the conversation and get out the records and have a sing-along?
We're all so excited.
We sang it right along. Ella didn't sing it, but Margaret and I are singing. Come along.
I hummed a little.
That was
come
the first
on.
Big capital.
Hold it. Before you get cranked up here, let me tell everybody who you are, and then we'll have a go at this. First of all, here is the original Victrola girl, Aileen Stanley, one of the great ladies of the entertainment world. She began in vaudeville at the age of 3. She went on to headline acts on the Pantages, the Orpheum, the Keith Albee, and the Schubert Circuits. She appeared on Broadway in Silks and Satins, A Night in Spain, many other shows. She sang with Al Jolson, Vincent Lopez, Phil Baker. By 1929, she already had sold over 25 million records for the Victor
She's
Company.
Beautiful.
Wow. Here is Loyce Whiteman, who is the very first big band singer. The location was the fabulous Coconut Grove here in Los Angeles. The band was Gus Arnheim. The year was 1931. At 18, fresh out of Glendale High School, she was signed to sing at the Grove with the fabulous Rhythm Boys, Bing Crosby, Harry Barris, and Al Rinker. She and Harry later married. They opened up the Coconut Grove in New York. You probably remember some of her great hits. They include I Don't Know Why, I Love You Like I Do, Mississippi Mud, I Surrender Dear, Dancing in the Dark, etc., etc., etc. Here now is Ella Mae Morse. Between 1952 and 1957, Ella Mae Morse sold over 50 million records. 10 of her recordings achieved gold record status, and her recording with the Freddie Slack Orchestra of Cow Cow Boogie was among the most popular songs of the entire 1940s. Today, she is still performing all over the country. As a matter of fact, she's going to get out of here early tonight because she's working at Ye Little Club over in Beverly Hills. What time is your show over there, dear?
I'm on right now. I hope I'm
well, have turned the set on in the bar. Lina Romay was Xavier Cugat's first female vocalist, the only one she didn't wind up married to. She toured with Kooky for 2 years and then signed with Joe Pasternak at MGM for 6 years. What'd you say, jailbait? Whoops. During World War II, she entertained servicemen around the world with her Latin programs on Armed Forces Radio. Some of her favorite songs, which you might remember, include Besame Mucho, Brazil, and Chiu Chiu Chiu. Did I say
good.
It right?
You got it right. Oh. You did it. Oh, Tom, that's wonderful.
K-Star, one of the most popular female vocalists of all time. K-Star has appeared with the big bands of Joe Venuti, Bob Crosby, Glenn Miller, Charlie Barnett. She has had an innumerable string of hit songs, including, to name a few, Wheel of Fortune, Angry, Side by Side, Ain't Nobody's Business, and she has long enjoyed an enormously successful solo career. What was the one that went, if the sun should tumble from the sky, da-da-da,
oh,
if you love me?
Oh, Him L'Amour, if you love me.
That wasn't Teresa Brewer's, was it?
No, it wasn't. Oh, no, make it that way.
Margaret Whiting has recorded over 500 songs in her long career as a singer. Greats like Moonlight in Vermont, Come Rain or Come Shine, Ain't We Got Fun. In the 40s, she was one of Capitol Records' first big recording stars. The first record she recorded for them became her first really big hit. It was called My Ideal. Since that time, she has earned 12 gold records. Now, in the early days, the big bands backed her up, and it wasn't until the last few years, during the recent revival of the big band sound, I'm trying to rush through this, that Margaret actually began to travel with the big bands with conductors like Freddie Martin, Bob Crosby, and George Shearing. That's all of them, all right.
You did it.
That's beautiful.
And tonight, Margaret Whiting is going to explain once and for all the difference between Moonlight in Vermont and Autumn in New York. Come on.
Oh,
do a few bars of each.
Okay.
They're so similar.
Autumn in New York. I do this.
But now do Moonlight
in Vermont. In a stream, falling leaves of sycamore, Moonlight in Vermont. One thing about that, Autumn in New York rhymes. Moonlight in Vermont doesn't. And Johnny Mercer, who found that song for me when we all started together in Capitol. And when he gave me that song, he said, it would really fit your voice and Billy Butterfield's trumpet, and we'll put you both together. But about 7 years ago, I was at the Rainbow Grill singing, and he came up to see me, and he said, you're going to sing the song, you know. And of course, the wonderful thing about it, Margaret, after all these years, you know that there isn't a rhyme in it. There and that's isn't. The first time I thought about it, and I blew every lyric when I went out on the floor. I had never thought about that.
Has it happened to any of you where you've been before a big audience for a concert, and you're doing the lyrics, and all of a sudden, nothing?
Yes.
Yes,
but I'm lucky.
All right, all of you take a turn. Tell.
I can fake it, because I spoke Spanish.
And I would be just, oh, so gracious, so lovely. I didn't know a word I was singing. I was making it up, and I'm sure if there were any Latins in the audience, they would say that poor girl ought to go back to school. Mm-hmm. But I really, you have to fake it, really.
Kate, what did Cugat do?
Oh, he was just so worried, and he just waved his wand, and he had what?
Did he understand you?
Oh, he understood me, of course.
Did it happen to you, too?
Were yes. I was with Joe Venuti's band, and I don't know if you know anything about Joe Venuti, but Joe Venuti is
how much is there to know about old Joe Venuti?
There's everything to know. But I was with him when I was just a kid. And I didn't get to see all the funny things. And every time somebody says, Joe Venuti, tell me about Joe Venuti, I can't tell him anything. I was with the band when I was 14 and 15 years old. Well, he says, the kid. And they'd always shut the door, and the kid never got to see anything. Mm-hmm. But we would work in New York, in Newark, and we'd work in the Bronx and those kind of places. And the kids would yell what they wanted to hear. And if you didn't know it, I mean, I'd had four songs. They were all stock arrangements. And I sang those four songs, and I was a little fat, dark girl, and everybody thought I was Italian. And they didn't want to let me go, she's one of us. Yeah. But they'd yell up songs, and George said, what do you want to hear? And they'd yell up this song, he'd say, do you know it? And I'd be standing, he'd hold me on the stage, and I'd say, well, I think I know. He says, play it and see.
Thank you, Joe.
Oh, yes, I think I've made up more lyrics than Johnny Mercer, probably. Lord,
yeah. Aileen, I said that you started in show business when you were 3 years old.
Yep.
What'd you do?
Well, I sang a few songs for different places.
Do you remember the first one you ever did?
What is it?
Remember the first one you ever did when you were three?
Well, a little song called Only Me. It was a little ballad. It was by two little girls, and one was loved and the other wasn't. One went to heaven and the other one stayed. Real sad little sob ballad. But I don't know. Conditions were so that I had to sing, so I did.
At the age of three.
Now, what do you mean conditions were such that you had to sing? You had to go out and work?
Well, we weren't so flush with money at that time. My daddy had passed on. Mm-hmm. My sister 3 weeks before him, and I was born 6 months later. And then my mother had to find a way to make a living. So she took my brother and I and put us in show business. But before that, she had to make her own way, and I gradually got into the business.
What was the first record you ever made for Victor?
I think the first record was I think it was Broadway Blues. I'm not sure now. I made so many for them.
Well, at $25 million, you would have to have made quite a number.
Well, it sold that many, you see. There was 140 I made.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know which one was first, really.
How did all of you get into this business of singing, and how? What is the age at which you start? Do you all start at now? Aileen started
she
at three, but
young.
Like, what age was it when you started to do this?
You mean professionally?
Yeah, yeah.
Tell me something. What makes you professional and what doesn't?
You get paid.
Oh, sure.
Many people say, when did you become professional?
When they call you an old pro.
Oh,
that's when you're professional.
All right. Yeah. But a lot of people have asked me, when did you become professional? Well, I want to know, does that mean the first time you ever walked on a stage?
No, no.
Or the first time you ever got paid?
When you get a check for it, then you become a pro.
I got paid under the table at Grace Hayes' Lodge because I was way underage, and my Aunt Margaret, who used to make records for Victor and was a very big recording star, Margaret Young, thought I should get my experience, and there was no place for me to go. I was going to school, so she took me out to Grace Hayes' Lodge, and Peter Lynn Hayes started with his mother, and all the stars used to come out there. I don't know if you ever knew about that place.
Did no,
you
ever go? No, I didn't.
I used to work out there.
Well, that it was sensational, and they got me...
In fact, to show you how little I know about it, I don't even know where it is.
It's out, it was an adventure.
It isn't anymore.
It's not there anymore. Grace is living in Las Vegas, but all the stars used to go out there, everybody from all the studios. It was fun, and they had wonderful shows. So they would say that we have a little girl here tonight. I was like 12 and 13, and they said her father was Richard Whiting, a songwriter, and she's going to be a singer, and let's get her up. And nobody ever questioned how the band knew all my songs, because I rehearsed, and they gave me $100 under the table. So I guess that was the beginning of my singing.
First
career.
Under the table pro.
That's right. The table pro. I got $100 a week.
Were any of you ever hired, and it turned up later that you were underage, and it might have become a problem or
it
anything?
It could have been, but for me. But
I was.
You were?
It was really weird. I got a job with Jimmy Dorsey's band,
And, you know, I had been trying for years to get every band that came into Dallas, I would go and either get an audition with them or drive them nuts until they told me to go home. And I finally, well, I told them how old I was, and this was a mistake, you know. So I got Jimmy on the phone, and he was auditioning girls, and he said, this is great, you know, you'll come tomorrow, and we'll have auditions, 2 o'clock, and I'll just be there. And by the way, how old are you? And I said, 19. This seemed like a good age, right? And wow.
Right now, it seems like a hell of a
I seemed rather old and mature then. You know, I was 12. And
12?
12, Ella, that's...
Oh, well, listen, I was an old pro, baby. I've been working, you know, with bands and things since I was 9. And $100 a week, Margaret, that's marvelous. I got $2.50 a night.
What do you think about me? I made more than Bing when I went in the Grove. Because they'd never had a girl sing.
What was the... wait, you didn't finish up, so...
Oh, well, he hired me, you know. I was very brazen, and I felt 19. I felt so marvelous. And my mother went along with the thing, because we really needed money, you know. I understand about that. I was kind of a depression baby, too, you know.
I think we're all depression babies.
I think so, except Margaret, you know.
Oh, come on.
Well, I had a father who wrote songs.
See there, and successfully. Yeah. But it was really strange. I wasn't doing that well. It wasn't because of what happened. You know, when I got to New York and saw all the big stars coming in, I would just die. You know, Robert Taylor came in, and Jimmy Stewart, and some of the real biggies, and I just died. And, you know, and my mouth would get full of cotton, and I couldn't sing, and I was just terrified. And I think he would have fired me anyway. But the thing that really clenched it was he got a letter from the Texas school board from Austin, our state capital. It said, it didn't request. It said, you will see to the education, the health, and the welfare of this minor child. And, oh, Matt, you know, it just terrified him.
What, did he give you the
and,
can?
He Bingo? Said, oh, kid. You know, he says, I don't need this. I don't need this. And they were getting ready to go into a theater. And Helen O'Connell replaced me, that beautiful lady. And she still is, you know. That is a beautiful girl.
She's a darling.
Beautiful.
Unbelievable.
Well, do you know something? I almost asked her to come in here tonight because I think she's singing down the road with Les Brown at the Palladium even as we speak.
She is.
Yeah. I think so.
Down the road.
And yeah, that's down the road. Isn't
it? In California, it's just down the road a piece.
It is just down the road.
Yeah,
yeah. I'm just down the road a piece too. Y'all come on over to me.
Why? We all hurry back here. Now here is Aileen Stanley as we go to a word from our affiliated stations. Now play a little of this before we cut away, gang. Aileen Stanley singing "Chili Bean." What year was this?
Chili Bean.
Uh huh.
I sang that. Well, that was 1919. It was made.
From
the Victor Company.
From 1919.
I was singing at the Carnegie Hall at that time.
Wow.
Well, I don't know if this record was made.
The first time they had the Clef Award there.
Listen, I want to play it. Is that okay?
Fine.
All right. Here is Aileen Stanley singing "Chili Bean" from 1919. It rhymes. Temple with the times.
Ago lived a girl named Chili, and the fellows loved her so. They loved her so. They loved her do re mi fa so. They were a lot of little profiteers that came from near and far. They loved her ta-da. She played on her guitar every night in the pale moonlight. They gather neath the stars. And
people wonder about this. They wonder if the band leader might fall in love with the lead female singer, or vice versa. I mean, how often does that
happen? Well, in the movies.
I don't know if Cougat was ever in love with me, but I think he loved me. He loved me because I was always ready to sing his songs. I sang them the way he wanted them. And I brought the people into the Waldorf Astoria, and they loved it. They left wanting to come back. But my career started quite differently than, in deference to Margaret. She has a background, a professional background, which I do not have. My father was in the diplomatic service, the Mexican government. And at the time, I had graduated from high school, literally went from the convent almost to the Waldorf Astoria, but was scheduled to go to college and never got there because Dad was in the consulate of Detroit as the acting consul, and he was a member of the Grosse Pointe Yacht Club. And every year we celebrate Pan American Day, as you know. And we had all of the Latin families in the area. We had a big party at the Grosse Pointe Yacht Club, And there was a newspaper man, Herschel Hart, rest his soul. He wrote a column for the Society column, and he thought I was delightful. So he decided that I should go to the local I sang the same thing that I sang with a little guitar. I play everything by ear, piano, guitar, drums, if you want it. And Cougat was appearing at the Statler. They gave me a local 15-minute program every afternoon from a quarter to 5 to 5. And as you girls know, with bands, 7 o'clock is the evening start. We have dinner show, dinner dancing. And at 5 o'clock, I presume Coogie was getting ready, bathing himself and getting himself, listening to his radio. And he heard me on the little local radio program. And he called the station. And they told him who I was. He called the consulate. He asked my father, would he bring me to dinner on a Friday evening? They had celebrity night. And so Dad asked me, did I want to go? And I said, oh, I do. I loved Cougat. I just thought he was so wonderful. And he was very popular. So we went on that Friday night. I sang the same songs with a little guitar. And Hank Greenberg was sitting way in the back. He was a big baseball player for the Detroit Tigers at the time. And his hands are massive. He stood up and he applauded with such aplomb. He was so thrilled, you know. And really, Coogie came and asked me that night, would I sing with his band? And I said, well, I don't know. I was very confused. I'd never done anything like this before.
Chicago training.
Oh, God. And so consequently, he said, well, you can sing with my niece. And I said, I don't know where I got the crust. I said, sing with your niece. I sing alone or nothing.
Nothing.
You know, really. I went back home. My father went back to New York. I went back to New York with my family. 3 weeks later, the telephone rang. And how he got my number, I don't know. But he invited me to the Waldorf Astoria to talk business. And that's how I started. $100 a week.
I was going to ask, what did they offer you at the time? $100
a week. No, I beg your pardon. Oh, that's a lot. $50 a week and $100 in the theater.
Oh, my.
And we played the Paramount, we played the Strand.
That was the going rate?
The going rate at that time.
I remember what, 5 years old.
I can't remember what I got.
The last time I did the Paramount Theater, we did 10 shows a day.
10?
10.
I did
that in Chicago once. 8:30, 9 o'clock in the morning until 12 o'clock at night. And the boys in the service lined up outside the street, 42nd Street.
I don't think we fully explored the subject of the relationship between the band leader and the lead female singer.
Well, Coogie was married to Carmen Castillo. That was his original wife, the real wife.
He wants to prove that
now. Great.
You never heard the story about the girl singers. If the whoever carried the girl singers' clothes, that was the fella for the week or the year or the month.
I know. Not when you were in one place like the girl for 2 years.
Well, I mean, they could carry something.
Well, the band boy carried mine. I paid him so much a month.
Well, as Margaret said, that's because you had convent training.
I didn't have a secret. Yeah.
I don't understand.
Honestly, I did.
We were just in Acapulco, and Charo was there. She claimed she came from the convent.
Oh,
I
she
think
did.
Charo looks.
Oh no, Charo did.
They
look, oh, yes.
In Spain. And you came from the convent.
Yes, we're the only two that are legitimate.
I'm strictly from Glendale, so.
Let me just blurt it out. Did any of you ever have affairs with your band leaders?
No.
Oh, good.
I never did.
I married one of the boys in the band.
I hate to tell you, Cougar was afraid of me.
He should have been.
I was too young. He was frightened.
What is it like when you're on the road doing the one-night stands?
Oh, tiring.
Murder.
Tiring.
It's, what was it, White Tower? Wasn't it White Tower?
Just recently. I guess you stopped White Towers.
White Towers with sandwiches.
The thing that happened.
Didn't you used to have to go on the bus, do the job,
the bus was
and then you'd have to get back on the bus and go on to the next town.
Right.
That's what they said.
I used to dress in the manager's office.
Oh, right.
And I was lucky if I had a sink in there.
You did say dress in the manager's office.
Dress in the manager's
office.
Well, you
know, Coogie was very fortunate. We didn't do a lot of traveling in a bus.
I never heard of
traveling
in a bus.
Coogie went from the Waldorf to theaters and from the Waldorf to the St. Louis to the Chase in St.
I don't
Louis,
know if you're lucky
the
enough.
Palmer House in Chicago.
I did do some on the bus.
I really did do some on the bus, but not that much.
Ella Mae is going to be leaving in a second,
so
I want to ask you this. Yeah. Can you tell when a song is brought to you whether it's going to work for you or not? Do you know just like that?
I have known, but you can't always tell.
Were you ever surprised by one that you thought was going to be great and it didn't, or vice versa?
I was surprised by one that I didn't think was going to make it, and it made it really big. And the stage door manager called, and I never didn't listen to a song. I've heard some pretty weird songs, Tom, like he's a super duper trooper in the army. Yeah. And you know, and everybody was a songwriter, and they probably still are. Mm-hmm. But this young man came up, and his name was Roy Jordan, and I had a piano in the dressing room. I was at the Strand with Charlie Barnett's band, and gad, he played this thing, and I just loved it. And I thought, because I do love it, probably nothing will happen, because I do not have my thumb on the pulse of the public, you know. And I sang it over the phone for Johnny Mercer. I was in New York, and John was out here on the West Coast, and he just loved it. He says, let's do it. You want to do it there, or wait till you come back home? So we wanted Skip Martin to make the arrangement, yeah. And he was unavailable at the time. So I said, well, we'll just wait until I get back, you know. So we made it. And by that time, I really knew it good. And we made it, you know, one afternoon, one take. And I thought, well, that's not going to make it. I could have done it better. You know, you always think that, yes. Don't you? I could have done it better than that, you know. Mm. And Patty Cake Man, son of a gun, it was just an immediate hit. And it really surprised me, because I thought, you know, for once I was right about the public liking it, you know.
What was the name of the song?
Patty Cake Man.
Oh, Patty Cake Man.
That was it.
Oh, I thought that
which
was a
little... Which sounds like a baby
now,
song, and but
you,
it really
when,
wasn't.
You do your repertoire over at the place a little later on. Do you do the old songs? You do some new with it, or...
Yeah, I kind of mix it up. I'm doing Cow Cow Boogie, of course, and and I'm doing God Bless the Child, which was written by Billie Holiday. And I like to say that because, you know, I've been doing
that's
that song
beautiful.
For years, and I just found out about 3 weeks ago that Billie Holiday wrote it.
Really?
Isn't that? See, I'm right on time with everything.
But, yes.
I'm doing Don't Get Around Much Anymore.
Oh,
you know, what's the show without Duke Ellington, right? And I'm doing Feelings, which I love.
Yeah,
it almost does itself, you know.
Yeah.
And
like
Sending the Clowns. And,
so you're contemporary
nostalgic
and, too.
And the nostalgia, because they enjoy that. It brings back their happy past, you know.
Oh, I hate to go and see a singer who's had great numbers, and he or she will ignore those and do something that you've never heard of.
I couldn't do that.
Yeah, think so.
You must.
Do as many as you can.
Listen,
right?
Thank you for... Well, you shortchanged your customers a little bit, and I wish you could stay longer.
I wouldn't have missed this.
But
it's
I know
so
you want to stay longer. You can stay as long as you want, but you be the judge.
Well, I've got to go. I don't want to go.
She's
know,
got to go.
I've got to go.
She's working. She's working.
Working. All right. Now, is The Wheel of Fortune the next song that we're going to hear by K-Star? Ella Mae Morse, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Happy, happy New Year
happy
to you.
Happy New Year
to
you,
friends,
too.
And to
happy
family.
New Year to all
God
of you.
Bless you.
God bless you, too.
Good night.
All right. Now, going into this word from our sponsors, here is K-Star and The Wheel of Fortune. Listen to this. Listen, you said something interesting about hearing yourself for the first time on a record and what that sounded like.
It was a terrible experience. You know, you make the record, and you, when you sing, you and I'm sure when you act or whatever you do professionally, you know you have an image of yourself. You know exactly how you sound, how it's going to come out. Except that when they first played My Ideal back to me, I fell out of bed. They played it on the radio. I think it was Al Jarvis played it for the first time. And I just said, no, that's why didn't I sing these notes better? Why did I breathe here? Oh, that's not good. That's terrible. And I still go through that.
Mm-hmm.
I still say, ooh, I shudder a little when I see myself on television, too.
Now, you made records in the day when they didn't have all of the sophisticated equipment where they
that's
could
right.
make it sound, forgive me,
thing.
Tinny would be the sound we'd call it now, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But when you heard yourself on those shellacs, or whatever they were...
Well, the first time I heard myself, I went up to the Pathé Company, and my mother said, when you go to New York, I want you to be sure and go make a record. And I said, okay, I'll do that. So I went in with my husband and we sang a little song and it sounded so bad. I said, can't we get out of here some way? I said, come on, let's go out the back way. He said, no, let's go in here what the guy has to say. So I went in and I sat down and Mr. Rose was the head of the Pathé company. And he said, well, he said, I don't think I'd be able to hold you. And I said, well, I'm sure of that. And he said, no. He said, would you mind if I tell you a few things to do? Because you'll be one of the biggest things on records. And I looked at him and I thought, the man must be crazy. So he said, go up to the Victor Company and tell them you want to make a test. The Victor Company, imagine. So I said, okay, Mr. Rose, I'll do that. And I went up to the Victor Company, and I got a call from them, and they said that they wanted to sign me exclusively. So I said, well, I have to go and see Mr. Rose first. So I went back to Mr. Rose, and he said, oh, he said, that's all right. He said, now you go up to Brunswick. So by the time I'd gotten through, he'd had me go up to about six or seven companies. And he said, now, he says, you tell each one that you will freelance. And he says, in that way I can have you. And I thought, what's this all about? So I was with William Rock Silks and Satins at that time. And the show was going on the road, and I'd gone pretty well of it. And Mr. Rock was very ill, and he wanted me to go on the road with him. And I said, well, Will, I said, I don't know whether I can go or not because I've got all these record companies coming after me. And I said, and I don't know what they're going to do. But I said, I think I ought to stay in town. And he was very sick, and I felt sorry for him. And I used to go to the theater early and put antiprogesting on his chest. Nobody believed he was
Nobody
sick.
Nobody knows antiprogesting but you and me.
What is antiprogesting?
Well, oh, it's a thing that takes pain away, see? And they didn't believe
a poultice.
So afterwards, they found out he did have pain and he died of cancer not long afterwards. So he said to me, Aileen, I'd love you to go on the road with me. And I said, well, I don't know what I can do. I'd love to, too, because I don't know what's going to happen here. And I said, I tell you what we'll do. I said, have you got a half a dollar? And he said, yeah. And I said, let's flip a coin. And I said, two out of three.
Well, that's the greatest dodge in the world, Aileen, is if you lose the first one, you figure you got one more coming back in case.
And I won. And I said, well, I guess I better stay. So I went to the Victor Company, and I did 12 sides for them a year. And I worked for Mr. Pathé, Mr. Rose, who was an angel. He took care of the whole thing for me. And by the time I got through, I was with about 14 companies. Mm-hmm. It just happened that I had a picture maybe in pronunciation and maybe a little imagination that happened to catch on the wax then.
You had a very unique sound.
Yes, and I was just lucky. Just a lucky girl, that was all. And so that's how my record career started. But I thought, and every time I'd hear my records when I'd go on the road or anywhere, I'd say to Bob, who's that? He'd say, that's you. I'd say, oh, no.
I must pause for these words from our affiliated stations. And now, here is Lina Romay singing Chiu Chiu Chiu. Ride.
Chiu, 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 chiu. Chiu, 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 chiu. Mira que la vida es triste y tu cantar me alegra el corazón. Chiu, 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 chiu. Chiu, 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 chiu.
One of the things that must make your work difficult is the fact that you are performing before audiences. Oftentimes, alcoholic beverages have been or are being served. Has it ever happened that somebody gets out of line while you're on stage?
Constant.